Go to southern France today and you might come across a structure that's nothing but amazing. There, you'll find the three-tier aqueduct known as the Pont du Gard. It's one of the best preserved Roman aqueducts anywhere in the world, and also the highest. But what's hard to get your head around is that this magnificent structure was built roughly 2,000 years ago in the 1st century AD. UNESCO has called it a testament to human genius. While no one disagrees that this ancient structure shows us that those Romans, or at least some of them, were exceptionally talented engineers, there are myriad buildings that tell us this, such as the Roman baths in the English town of Bath, or the mighty Pantheon, still both in good condition. The question is, how did they do it, and can we recreate their incredible formula today? Let's first have a look at when the Romans got their hands on concrete. The Romans were masters at making concrete, but they didn't start using some form of concrete until around the 3rd century BC. There's even a period known as the Roman Concrete Revolution, which is when engineers experienced an explosion in their use of very creative building processes and architectural elements thanks to the incredible concrete formula that they could exploit to build much more impressive structures. Without this concrete, we wouldn't have all those amazing structures still standing today. The ancient Romans, of course, didn't call it concrete, but the Latin words opus caementicium. It would be an understatement to say concrete was important to the Romans because it helped build a lot of things they were famous for, such as the large Roman edifices, houses, those great bridges, and those tough Roman roads we've all heard about. But how did they make this amazing concrete of theirs? Historians tell us that their magic formula for opus caementicium was to add a volcanic dust called pozzolana to a mortar that was made from lime or gypsum with bits of rock, brick, tile, and some water added. As many of you know, to mix concrete you have to add each part carefully, making sure not to have too much or too little of any one thing. The Romans did just that, perfecting the exact ratio that yielded the strongest concrete. They would mix the mortar and then add to it the pozzolana. And for every one part volcanic dust, there would be 3 parts lime or gypsum. Historians tell us that the magic was in the volcanic ash, because it contained silica and alumina, which together in the mix created a chemical reaction that strengthened the mortar. Voila! Perfect Roman concrete and structures all over the place which would stand up straight for centuries, long after the empire itself had fallen. But as we said, there was a concrete revolution, and during this phase, the Romans would advance their concrete, making it even stronger, and learn how to make it waterproof. The genius who came up with waterproof concrete found that by adding crushed terracotta, that would do the job. In the 1st century AD, they even figured out that by mixing a certain amount of volcanic ash and lime and letting it sit in seawater, that it would harden the concrete over time. That's why you have Roman structures that have stood in the water for 2,000 years that are still standing, whereas modern concrete would deteriorate in the salt water. That concrete is reinforced with steel, too, and steel doesn't like salt water. In fact, Roman marine concrete has been called the most durable building material in human history. So you might now be wondering, if Roman concrete was that good, and it obviously was, why don't we use it now? Well, you can find research out there that indeed tells us that Roman concrete was superior to the stuff we use today. In fact, recent research conducted by the US Department of Energy and scientists at the University of California tell us that the best Roman concrete was not just more durable than modern concrete, but it's less environmentally damaging to make it. One of those researchers said in an interview, "It's not that modern concrete isn't good. It's so good we use 19 billion tons of it a year. The problem is that manufacturing Portland cement accounts for 7% of the carbon dioxide that industry puts into the air. Portland cement is the glue that holds everything together, but the process of making it releases carbon from burning fuel. To make it, you mix silica sand, limestone, clay, chalk, and more, and then melt it together at super high temperatures. Some of those researchers believe that if we go back to using Roman concrete, not only will there be less carbon emissions, but we'll also have longer lasting structures, which is also good for the environment. Surely, we should be going back to the stuff made with volcanic ash." Some environmentally friendly concretes these days do take the Roman route, and the results have been good. Another good thing, according to scientists, is that the world does not have a shortage of pozzolana. One of the reasons we haven't been using marine Roman concrete is pretty simple, and that's because scientists just didn't know for a while what just the magic was. For instance, a study published in the American Mineralogist in 2017 explained to us how when seawater gets into the Roman concrete, the minerals actually toughen the concrete over time, not weaken it. We should add, though, that this toughening process can take a century or two, so modern scientists are working on something that won't take so long. Surely, then, we can just make it? Well, it's not that easy, because the Romans didn't leave behind the exact recipe, and it seems us moderns have not been able to perfect the process just yet. One scientist said that the recipe for Roman marine concrete was completely lost. Another scientist, in an interview with The Guardian in 2017, said more work needs to be done in creating those mixtures. A bit of fine-tuning needs to happen, he said, adding that the challenge is to develop methods that use common volcanic products, and that is actually what we're doing right now. Nonetheless, as we said, that volcanic ash is used in some concretes today. As one researcher put it, engineers are by no means ignorant regarding how good this stuff is. But the one thing we want to have is the concrete that strengthens in seawater, as that's where our modern concrete has a lot of problems. Those scientists are trying hard to reverse engineer marine Roman concrete, but as we speak, we still can't make it like the Romans did. Another researcher said that the Romans got lucky in what rocks they had available to throw into the mix, and in much of the world today you won't find those rocks, so substitutes would have to be found. And at this point it's worth saying that the new school way of making concrete with Portland cement is relatively cheap, so while it might be worse for the environment, businesses will always think about the bottom line. And concrete is big business. So big, in fact, that it's said Portland cement accounts for around 5% of human greenhouse gas emissions. That's what an article in Nature.com tells us. And that's why researchers right now are trying to master how to make what's sometimes called one of the most complex substances known in material science. That same article said some progressive companies in the USA are working on the Roman concrete model to help reduce carbon emissions. But it also said those companies are merely bit players in the concrete business. What we need, according to that piece, is everyone in the construction industry to embrace the next generation cement. With that in mind, don't be surprised if we soon start doing it like the Romans did. As one professor told the Washington Post, the Romans formulated a material that still wows us today. Perhaps we'll have to go back to the past to create a better, more sustainable future. What do you think? Do you know enough about concrete to add something more to this story? Tell us in the comments. Also, be sure to check out our other video, The Horrible Life of an Average Roman Empire Slave. Thanks for watching, and as always, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. See you next time!